vaccine is a whole virus vaccine. It's very simple in the sense that the whole virus is either attenuated or deactivated, and this actually used as a vaccine because the vaccine is a weakened or deactivated form of the pathogenic process coordinating to trigger the immunity to it. So you either attenuate the COVID-19 virus or you deactivate the virus and produce a vaccine out of it. That's called whole virus vaccine, and it's a very traditional form of a vaccine. In fact, lots of vaccines have been produced using whole viruses. For example, rabies vaccine, hepatitis A vaccine. If you look at any pharmacopoeia, old pharmacopoeia, you will see that most of the vaccines are produced by inactivation of viruses, basically inactivation. So the whole virus vaccines are mostly produced by inactivated or inactivation or attenuation of the virus, basically. So Chinese vaccines, COVID vaccines like Sinopharm and Sinovac are based on this technology, that is whole virus vaccines. Since the pathogen is inactivated, it cannot infect cells and replicate, but can evoke an immune response. So killing of the deactivation of the pathogen does not mean that it cannot evoke immune response, because immune response evoking is dependent on the structural proteins. That is, so as long as the proteins are intact, even though the virus may be inactive, you can still elicit an immune response. That is the scientific principle behind using inactivated viruses as vaccines. So they were one of the earliest to be developed inactivated viruses. Towards the 19th century, the first inactivated vaccines were developed by Salmon in the United States and Smith in the Pasteur Institute group in France. That was towards the 19th century. Now, what discovery led to the adoption of this particular technology? It was found that if bacteria can be killed, they can still have evoke an immune response. So since bacteria can evoke an immune response even if they are killed by chemical treatment or heat, the same logic was applied to viruses also. So viruses also could actually can also evoke an immune response even though they are inactivated. That is the principle behind the whole virus vaccine. However, after successive attempts and strategies, various scientists, the 20th century, the first vaccine, that is whole virus vaccine, was the influenza vaccine. Influenza vaccine is the first whole virus vaccine to come out. Second was actually beta propiolactin inactivated viral vaccine, was a rabies vaccine. So first is influenza virus, then rabies virus. Then finally, we have got the polio vaccine, which came out in 1950, which was the third whole virus vaccine to be produced in the world, actually. So we have got influenza, rabies, and polio vaccine in the among the earliest vaccines produced by whole virus vaccine technology. So they are produced by inactivating the we can't use the term killing for viruses because we don't consider viruses as living organisms. So we can say they are produced by inactivating the organisms that cause disease through physical or chemical processes. This destroys the pathogen's ability to replicate, but keeps it intact so that the immune response can still recognize it and produce an immune response. So immune system can recognize the inactivated viruses and can still produce an immune response, which will be active against live pathogens. Now, till date, several inactivated viral vaccines have been produced. They are namely against hepatitis A, influenza, polio, rabies, and they offer excellent protection. These inactivated vaccines will be administered along with adjuvants. Adjuvants are basically substances which actually increase the immune response. That is, the adjuvant is basically an inert substance which does not interfere with the efficacy of the vaccine, but which actually causes the immune response to be stronger. That's why we call them adjuvant. So adjuvants are to immune response produced. Adjuvant is an ingredient used in some vaccines that helps create a stronger immune response in people receiving the vaccine. So some of the adjuvants commonly used are aluminium salts like aluminium hydroxide, aluminium phosphate, aluminium potassium sulfate. They have been used for vaccines for more than 70 years. In fact, I was associated with the hepatitis B vaccine recombinant, and we used to add this aluminium hydroxide gel in the final stage for formulating. So you generally add the adjuvant when you formulate the vaccine. So until the vaccine is formulated, it remains an antigen protein. So once you mix the adjuvant with the antigen, it becomes a vaccine. So when we add aluminium hydroxide gel to hepatitis B surface antigen protein, what you get is the hepatitis B vaccine. So similar to that, If you add this adjuvant to any preparation which is going to become going to act as a become the vaccine, then addition of adjuvant to the active ingredient will make it a vaccine. So process involved in the development of let us see briefly the process. As you can see here, which select a bacterial or viral strain for the against the disease, then inactivated using heating or chemicals. Then the vaccine is produced by actually harvesting the organism cells and then by formulating them properly. Then you inject the inactivated vaccine into the patient into people. Then you get neutralizing antibodies finally and immune responses evoke. This is briefly this is the process. It's a very simple process. Production of inactivated vaccine is quite well known. It's not a new technology, but still, it is being adopted worldwide because they provide excellent protection. Now, let's look at the steps basically. So, whole viruses or bacteria are extracted and grown in culture. Viruses or bacteria that are inactivated by killing or by chemicals such as formalin or formaldehyde or beta propiolactone, which is BPL. Then the inactivated viruses or bacteria are then produced in large quantities, means. So that we will produce millions of doses of the vaccine so that they can be given to the entire population prepared for use of vaccine. So what are the advantages of one of vaccines? Because they are proven to be extremely safe as don't contain any live components. So since the organisms in the vaccine are completely inactivated, there's no question of any disease spreading from that. The pathogen is completely inactivated. So there's no question of any disease or the disease being caused by the pathogen. It can be given to special populations such as old people, geriatric populations, pregnant women, and also to children, infants, babies basically. So they can be given to that. And they also ensure stability for long-term storage. And technically you require only few regulatory hurdles, means because this is a well-known technology, the regulatory authorities are not very strict about production of this inactivated vaccines basically, because the technology has been adopted worldwide and for many vaccines, so people know exactly it's a proven technology. It's a proven technology, and so you don't encounter too many technical regulatory hurdles for getting the license. And they cater to the environment of the current healthcare environment, where the focus is on reducing costs while improving overall patient care. So since this is an old technology, the cost of implementing this technology is also less compared to other advanced technologies. So in a scenario where cutting cost is important, this traditional whole virus vaccines technology is very useful. Some examples for this are Bharat Biotech is producing Covaxin. Covaxin is produced exactly by this technology, that is whole virus vaccine technology, where you have the inactivated virus, which itself acts as the vaccine. So inactivated virus is chemically inactivated with a chemical agent called beta propiolactone. That is the coronavirus is inactivated using this chemical, and then it's injected, vaccine is prepared and it's injected into the into people. And since the virus entire is intact, only it's inactive, it's able to elicit immune response. That is so next is Sinopharm. Sinopharm again uses the same technology, which is a Chinese company. And dosing is around two doses, 21 days apart. Whereas in the case of Bharat Biotech, it's actually two doses, 28 days apart, the vaccination, that is the gap between the vaccines. And Sinopharm is actually two doses, 21 days apart. Storage is at 28 degrees Celsius. Next is subunit vaccine. Now, later on, this technology came into being. That is, people started that, is it necessary to actually inactivate the whole organism and then use it as a vaccine? Can't we take a part of the organism and use it as a vaccine? So that's what we call subunit vaccines came into existence. Subunit means can be a part of the pathogen. It can be a surface protein mostly. So instead of taking the whole organism, you take only a part of the organism, which is exposed to the immune system basically in the world. So if you take a surface protein, we obviously know that the surface of the pathogen is going to be exposed to the immune system. So in that case, if you take the surface protein of an organism, of a virus, and then if you prepare a vaccine using that particular surface protein, then it's possible to get the same immune response using a smaller part of the surface of the organism basically. So that's why you call them as subunit vaccines. They contain purified pieces of the vaccine, which have been specially selected for the ability to stimulate immune cells. Hepatitis B vaccine recombinant is a very common example of a subunit vaccine. So what people have done is they have taken the gene for the surface protein, a small protein from the surface hepatitis B virus. They cloned the gene into a plasmid, and they have actually integrated a plasmid into a host cell, suitable host cell, which actually integrates the plasmid into the chromosome. And then when the organism multiplies, the gene also multiplies. You've got this gene of that particular subunit protein in high copy number. So from that, the gene will be expressed actually, and the subunit protein will be expressed by the yeast cell, the recombinant yeast cell, and the yeast will be harvested, the cells will be broken, and vaccine will be prepared. So that's how subunit vaccines are prepared. And I was actually working for hepatitis B recombinant. I was in the team who were manufacturing hepatitis B recombinant vaccine. So since I was with the team, I know exactly how it is being done. So I gave an example of subunit vaccine recombinant. And this is the fragments are capable of causing a disease. Subunit vaccines are considered very safe because at least in whole virus, people may have some doubt that is the whole virus is there, they can cause. But in this case, there's no question of any disease being caused by the vaccine because you are taking only a small part of the pathogen. That is. Now, types of subunit vaccines. So briefly, there are three different types of subunit vaccines. Protein subunit vaccines, they contain specific isolated proteins from viral or bacterial pathogens. Example, hepatitis B vaccine, which I mentioned just now, hepatitis B vaccine. The polysaccharide vaccines are there because contains chains of sugar molecules found in the cell walls of many bacteria. For example, pneumococcal polysaccharide vaccine is a common example of polysaccharide vaccines. Then conjugated subunit vaccines, where the polysaccharide chain is actually bound to a carrier protein to boost the immune response. For example, meningococcal ACWY vaccine, which is a conjugate vaccine, which contains polysaccharides from CWY zero groups of this meningococcus organism, and that is coupled to diphtheria or tetanus toxoid and given together basically. Now we are also developing only protein subunit vaccines for COVID-19. It is only protein means where the subunit is only protein. Till now we have not developed that actually. Novavax is basically a company USA which actually produces nanoparticle coated vaccines basically. So here nanoparticles are actually coated with the different spike proteins of the coronavirus, and when the nanoparticle vaccine is actually injected into the into people, what happens is since the spike proteins are exposed to the immune system, they cause antibody production and the immune response is caused. So this particular vaccine product gives around 96% protection against the original strain, 86% protection against the UK variant, and 58% protection against the South African variant, and it requires two doses of 21 days apart. So like then there's something called viral vector vaccine. So viral vector vaccines, they differ from most conventional vaccines that they don't actually introduce the antigen into the body basically. Here, what is the antigen? Antigen is the surface protein or some part of the virus or the pathogen. So these vector virus based vaccines do not directly introduce the antigen into the people's bodies. Instead, they cause the biochemical machinery of the cells of the human body to manufacture these antigens themselves. So here, what these viral vector vaccines do is that through them, you can actually introduce the genetic material of the virus, that is the pathogen, into the human body. And when the genetic material reaches the cells, genetic material uses the machinery of the person, biochemical machinery, to synthesize the antigens themselves. And since the antigens are foreign proteins to the human body, automatically there will be an immune response by the body against these antigens. So the adenovirus based the viral vector vaccines, actually examples are Johnson & Johnson's vaccine, which is actually again a viral vector vaccine. Similarly, Sputnik V is an adenovirus, it's a viral vector vaccine, and also our Covishield or Oxford vaccine. These three are actually viral vector based vaccines. They don't actually introduce the any pathogenic, any part of the pathogen into the human body. They just need to the DNA, the genetic material, which will enter the host cell, means the people's cell, the body cells, and then they cause the cells to produce the actual antigen, which is going to actually elicit an immune response. So the immune system detects those the antigen protein manufactured by the human body as foreign proteins, and then they actually develop an immune response against those proteins. So that's how the viral vector vaccines work basically. So by infecting cells and instructing them to make large amounts of antigen, which then trigger an immune response, the vaccine mimics. So what viral vector vaccines, how they work is that they exactly work when the scenario is very similar to exactly the same as when an actual pathogen infects the human body. Only thing is that the viral vector here is not a pathogen. It only introduces the genetic material, that is the DNA here. To the, after that, whatever happens is very similar to actual infection, which happens when the organism infects. So by giving the genetic material into the to the human body, the viral vector vaccines will cause the human bodies to actually manufacture the vaccine using their own biochemical machinery to produce the antigen against which the immune response will be mounted. This advantage of triggering a short, strong cellular and the immune response by T cells, as well as the production of antibodies by B cells. Example of viral vector vaccines, the RVSV Zebo vaccine against Ebola, which is the old one. Now we can see our own coronavirus vaccines based on this technology. That is, so as you can see, the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine is based upon adenovirus based technology. Here, double stranded DNA encoding the spike protein is protected in a safe virus. Infected cell expresses the spike protein, that is human cell, which leads to immune response. So efficacy of this vaccine is 82% against the original strain, and 10% against South Africa variant, not very much. And two doses are given 12 weeks apart. That is the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine, which is very popular in India. It's also called as AOX1 or AZD1222, that is Covishield, as they call it in India. Then Johnson & Johnson vaccine, which is actually widely used in USA, against its viral vector vaccine. A double stranded DNA is encoding the spike proteins, actually enclosed sent into a cell through adenovirus, which actually passes the genetic material into the cells. Cells will express the spike protein, and then immune response is mounted. Efficacy is 72% against original strain. And then moderate to severe cases, 57% against the South Africa variant. Only one dose is sufficient for this. Unlike other vaccines, which require two doses, Johnson & Johnson requires only one dose. Then finally, Sputnik V, which is also being adopted in India. That's Gamaleya Institute by Russia, who developed this vaccine. Again, double stranded DNA. Actually, if you see here, the Gamaleya vaccines, they actually code for two different proteins. That is, first is AD26 spike protein, second dose is AD20-85, basically. So there's slight variation here, actually. Whereas in the previous case also, actually, there's only one protein, basically. Whereas in this case, Sputnik V, it is two proteins. So first dose is based upon AD20, second is based upon AD5. So double-stranded DNA, again, code encoding for the spike protein is encapsulated in a virus. Infected cell, again, will actually produce the antigen, that is the spike protein, which against which immune response will be given. So efficacy is 91% against the original strain. The efficacy against the other strain variant is not known. Dosing is 0.5 ml dose, two doses, 21 days apart, again, for the Russian Gamaleya vaccine. Now, DNA vaccines. So till now, we have seen inactivated vaccines. Then we saw subunit vaccines. Then we saw adenovirus-based viral vector vaccines. Now we'll see DNA vaccines. Now, DNA vaccines, the name itself implies, they consist of a piece of DNA encoding the antigen. It's first inserted into a bacterial plasmid. So take the gene coding for a particular protein, encoding the antigen, and then insert the bacterial plasmid. Inject the plasmid into a host as a vaccine. Then the DNA plasmids carrying the antigen are usually injected into the muscle. Now, one of the challenges here is to how to get the DNA fragment into the cell. Because once you give DNA, the biochemical machinery of the human body has to use the DNA to manufacture the antigen using its own biochemical machinery. So, but since the biochemical machinery is situated inside the cell, the challenge is to get the DNA into the cell, basically. With the case of adenovirus the vaccines, based vaccines, the adenovirus is able to directly inject the genetic material into the cells. But in this case, since we are injecting only the DNA, we have to find some means to get the DNA into the cells using. So, because of machinery for producing the converting, translating the DNA into the protein is present in the cells only. So various technologies have been developed to aid this process. Such as electroporation is basically using small pulses of electric current to create temporary pores in the membrane through which DNA can be injected. Second is a gene gun, which uses helium to propel DNA into cells, into skin cells. Then encapsulating the DNA. And the third is to encapsulate the DNA in nanoparticles so that which can be taken by the cell, which can fuse the cell membrane. So these three technologies are used to send the DNA into the cells, because unlike in adenovirus vector vaccine, where the virus directly is able to send the DNA into the cells, here, since the vaccine is just pure DNA of the particular antigen protein, there should be a means to send the DNA into the cells. So these are the technologies being explored. So ZyCoV-D is an example of DNA vaccine. ZyCoV-D is basically coronavirus vaccine, which contains the instructions for making spike protein against the SARS-CoV-2 spike protein. It is produced by Zydus Cadila, that is Ahmedabad-based company. They have developed this technology basically. This is the only DNA vaccine. Incidentally, it is the only DNA vaccine in the world for COVID-19. Vaccination gives the code to the cells in the recipient's body that begin making the spike protein, the virus. The immune system of the recipient recognizes this and develops antibodies in response. Vaccine is administered intradermally using the spring mechanism that delivers the shot as a narrow stream of fluid penetrating the skin. As you can see the picture here, you got a DNA pathogen here. DNA, the antigen part of the DNA is actually taken and cloned into a plasmid, and that is actually inserted into injected into the human body. And by one of the technologies which you have spoken about, electroporation or a gene gun or encapsulation, the DNA enters the cells, and then the cells will actually manufacture the translate the DNA into the foreign protein, and then they actually express the surface. So cells will express the protein on the surface, and when the cells express the protein on the surface, immune response is generated against the particular foreign protein. So this is a way by which DNA vaccine works, and Zydus Cadila is an example of Indian company which has produced the world's first DNA vaccine against coronavirus, that is SARS-CoV-2 infection. Next is mRNA vaccines. Now, mRNA vaccines encode the antigen of interest. The mRNA vaccines are basically, in fact, it's halfway closer to the target. That is, DNA vaccines, DNA has to be translated to mRNA, and the mRNA has to be expressed as protein. But here you are supplying the mRNA of the pathogen of the antigen of interest itself to the human body. Because of its transitory nature, there's no zero risk of integrating into our own genetic material. mRNA can be injected by itself, encapsulated by nanoparticles, or driven into the cells using some of the same techniques being developed for DNA. So like a gene gun, electroporation, and encapsulation techniques can be used to send mRNA into the cells. And the mRNA, safe thing is that it does not integrate with without disturb the human germ in any way. And in fact, once the mRNA enters the cell, after instructions are taken to actually synthesize the protein, the mRNA will be destroyed. It won't be intact in the cell. So Moderna is a company in USA which makes encapsulated mRNA vaccine. So the mRNA encoding for the spike protein is protected in a lipid nanoparticle like a soap bubble. Once absorbed, the cell expresses the spike protein, resulting in immune response. So efficacy is 94% of the original strain. Efficacy is not known against South Africa variant, and storage is around -20 Celsius for 6 months and 2 degrees Celsius for 30 days. Again, it takes 2 doses for this vaccine, 28 days apart. That is, gap is 28 days. So this is Moderna, a US-based company producing mRNA vaccine against SARS-CoV-2. Again, BioNTech, Pfizer, again, they are producing mRNA vaccine. Pfizer, again, is a US-based company. And BioNTech, actually, the company is a German-based company, basically. So they have collaborated to make this BioNTech, Pfizer vaccine. Again, mRNA is actually encapsulated in a suitable nanoparticle, and then the technology is the same. The spike proteins, the mRNA for spike protein is given into the cells. The human cells synthesize the spike protein, and then immune system actually recognize that and develops the antibodies for this. Efficacy is 96%. However, storage temperature is around minus 70 degrees Celsius. And because since this vaccine is has not been wrapped in India very widely, because India, we don't have stringent storage facilities for large amounts of vaccine, that is around minus 70 Celsius. So it's better to go for, that's why we have found it better to go for other vaccines where the temperature storage is much higher compared to minus 70 degrees Celsius. So this is the only problem with the BioNTech Pfizer vaccine, because storage temperature is very low, minus 70 degrees Celsius. So this is a brief thing, how mRNA COVID vaccine, 9 vaccines work. Like the one that COSPO is named after the crown-like spikes on their surface called spike proteins. mRNA basically is, you know, it's a messenger RNA, which is actually copied from the DNA basically. And when it goes into the cell, it does not disturb the genome of the host genome. It actually only delivers instructions for manufacturing the protein. And once the protein is actually manufactured, the mRNA is destroyed. So that's why mRNA vaccines are quite safe. So that actually completes the presentation on this COVID-19 vaccines, current technologies for that. Thank you.
Dear participants, the chat box has been opened. If you have any queries, you can post your queries in the chat box. I repeat.
It's a whole virus vaccine. It's very simple in the sense that the whole virus is either attenuated or deactivated. And this actually used as a vaccine because the vaccine is a weakened or deactivated form of the pathogenic process coordinating trigger the immunity to it. So you either attenuate the COVID-19 virus or you deactivate the virus and produce a vaccine out of it. That's called whole virus vaccine, and it's a traditional form of a vaccine. In fact, lots of vaccines have been produced using whole viruses. For example, rabies vaccine, hepatitis A vaccine. If you look at any pharmacopoeia, old pharmacopoeia, you will see that most of the vaccines are produced by inactivation of viruses, basically. So whole virus vaccines are mostly produced by inactivation or attenuation of the virus, basically. So Chinese vaccines, COVID vaccines like Sinopharm and Sinovac are based on this technology, that is whole virus vaccines. Since the pathogen is inactivated, it cannot infect cells and replicate, but can evoke an immune response. So killing of the deactivation of the pathogen does not mean that it cannot evoke immune response, because immune response evoking is dependent on the structural proteins. That is, so as long as the proteins are intact, even though the virus may be inactive, you can still elicit an immune response. That is the scientific principle behind using inactivated viruses as vaccines. So they were one of the earliest to be developed inactivated viruses. Towards the 19th century, the first inactivated vaccines were developed by Salmon in the United States and Smith in the Pasteur Institute group in France. That was towards the 19th century. Now, what discovery led to the adoption of this particular technology? It was found that if bacteria can be killed, they can still have an evoke an immune response. So since bacteria can evoke an immune response even if they are killed by chemical treatment or heat, the same logic was applied to viruses also. So viruses also could actually can also evoke an immune response even though they are inactivated. That is the principle behind the whole virus vaccine. However, after successive attempts and strategies, many scientists, the 20th century, the first vaccine, that was whole virus vaccine, was the influenza vaccine. Influenza vaccine is the first whole virus vaccine to come out. Second was actually beta-propiolactin inactivated viral vaccine, was a rabies vaccine. So first is influenza virus, then rabies virus. Then finally, we have got the polio vaccine, which came out in 1950, which was the third whole virus vaccine to be produced in the world, actually. So we have got influenza, rabies, and polio vaccine among the earliest vaccines produced by whole virus vaccine technology. So they are produced by inactivating the, we can't use the term killing for viruses because we don't consider viruses as living organisms. So we can say they are produced by inactivating the organisms that cause disease through physical or chemical processes. This destroys the pathogen's ability to replicate, but keeps it intact so that the immune response can be can system can still recognize it and produce an immune response. So immune system can recognize the inactivated viruses or and can they can still produce an immune response which will be active against live pathogens. Now till date several inactivated viral vaccines have been produced. They are namely against hepatitis A, influenza, polio, rabies, and they offer excellent protection. These inactivated vaccines will be administered along with adjuvants. Adjuvants are basically substances which actually increase the immune response. That is, the adjuvant is basically an inert substance which does not interfere with the efficacy of the vaccine, but which actually causes the immune response to be stronger. That's why we call them adjuvant. So adjuvants are to immune response produced. Adjuvant is an ingredient used in some vaccines that helps create a stronger immune response in people receiving the vaccine. So some of the adjuvants commonly used are aluminium salts like aluminium hydroxide, aluminium phosphate, aluminium potassium sulfate. They have been used for vaccines for more than 70 years. In fact, I was associated with the hepatitis B vaccine recombinant, and we used to add this aluminium hydroxide gel in the final stage for formulating. So you generally add the adjuvant when you formulate the vaccine. So until the vaccine is formulated, it remains an antigen protein. So once you mix the adjuvant with the antigen, it becomes a vaccine. So when we add aluminium hydroxide gel to hepatitis B surface antigen protein, what you get is the hepatitis B vaccine. So similar to that, if you add this adjuvant to any preparation which is going to become going to act as become the vaccine, then addition of adjuvant to the active ingredient will make it a vaccine. So process in order the development of let us see briefly the process. As you can see here, which select a bacterial or viral strain for the against the disease, then inactivated using heating or chemicals. Then the vaccine is produced by actually harvesting the organism cells and then by formulating them properly. Then you inject the inactivated vaccine into the patient into people. Then you get neutralizing antibodies finally and immune responses evoked. This is briefly this is the process. It's a very simple process. Production of inactivated vaccine is quite well known. It's not a new technology, but still it is being adopted worldwide because they produce excellent protection. Now let's look at the steps basically. So whole viruses or bacteria are extracted and grown in culture. Viruses or bacteria that are inactivated by killing or by chemicals such as formalin or formaldehyde or beta propiolactone, which is BPL. Then the inactivated viruses or bacteria are then produced in large quantities, means so that we will produce millions of doses of the vaccine so that they can be given to the entire population prepared for use of vaccine. So what are the advantages of polio vaccines? Because they are proven to be extremely safe as don't contain any live components. So since the organisms in the vaccine are completely inactivated, there's no question of any disease spreading from that. The pathogen is completely inactivated. So there's no question of any disease or the disease being caused by the pathogen. It can be given to special populations such as old people, geriatric populations, pregnant women, and also to children, infants, babies basically. So they can be given to that. And they also ensure stability for long-term storage. And technically you require only few regulatory hurdles, means because this is a well-known technology, the regulatory authorities are not very strict about production of this inactivated vaccines because the technology has been adopted worldwide and for many vaccines. So people know exactly, it's a proven technology. It's a proven technology. And so you don't encounter too many technical regulatory hurdles for getting the license. And they cater to the new requirement of the current healthcare environment where the focus is on reducing costs while improving overall patient care. So since this is an old technology, the cost of implementing this technology is also less compared to other advanced technologies. So in a scenario where cutting cost is important, this traditional whole virus vaccines technology is very useful. Some examples for this are Bharat Biotech is producing Covaxin. Covaxin is produced exactly by this technology, that is whole virus vaccine technology, where you have the inactivated virus, which itself acts as the vaccine. So inactivated virus is chemically inactivated with a chemical agent called beta propiolactone. That is the coronavirus is inactivated using this chemical, and then it's injected, vaccine is prepared and it's injected into the into people. And since the virus entire is intact, only it's inactive, it's able to elicit immune response. That is so next is Sinopharm. Sinopharm again uses the same technology, which is a Chinese company. And dosing is around two doses, 21 days apart. Whereas in the case of Bharat Biotech, it's actually two doses, 28 days apart, the vaccination, that is the gap between the vaccines. And Sinopharm is actually two doses, 21 days apart. Storage is at 28 degrees Celsius. Next is subunit vaccine. Now, later on, this technology came into being. That is, people started that, is it necessary to actually inactivate the whole organism and then use it as a vaccine? Can't we take a part of the organism and use it as a vaccine? So that's what we call subunit vaccines came into existence. Subunit means can be a part of the pathogen. It can be a surface protein mostly. So instead of taking the whole organism, you take only a part of the organism, which is exposed to the immune system, basically, in the world. So if you take a surface protein, we obviously know that the surface of the pathogen is going to be exposed to the immune system. So in that case, if you take the surface protein of an organism, of a virus, and then if you prepare a vaccine using that particular surface protein, then it's possible to get the same immune response using a small part of the surface of the organism, basically. So that's why you call them as subunit vaccines. They contain purified pieces of the vaccine, which have been specially selected for the ability to stimulate immune cells. Hepatitis B vaccine recombinant is a very common example of a subunit vaccine. So what people have done is they have taken the gene for the surface protein, a small protein from the surface hepatitis B virus. They cloned the gene into a plasmid, and they have actually integrated a plasmid into a host cell, suitable host cell, which actually integrates the plasmid into the chromosome. And then when the organism multiplies, the gene also multiplies. You've got this gene of that particular subunit protein in high copy number. So from that, the gene will be expressed actually, and the subunit protein will be expressed by the yeast cell, the recombinant yeast cell, and the yeast will be harvested, the cells will be broken, and vaccine will be prepared. So that's how subunit vaccines are prepared. And I was actually working for hepatitis B recombinant, I was in the team. Who are manufacturing hepatitis B recombinant vaccine. So since I was with the team, I know exactly how it is being done. So that's why I gave an example of subunit vaccine recombinant. And this is the fragments are capable of causing a disease. Subunit vaccines are considered very safe because at least in whole virus, people may have some doubt that is the whole virus is there, they can cause. But in this case, there's no question of any disease being caused by the vaccine because you are taking only a small part of the pathogen. That is. No, types of subunit vaccines. So briefly, there are three different types of subunit vaccines. Protein subunit vaccines, they contain specific isolated proteins from viral or bacterial pathogens. Example, hepatitis B vaccine, which I mentioned just now, hepatitis B vaccine. The polysaccharide vaccines are there because contains chains of sugar molecules found in the cell walls of many bacteria. For example, pneumococcal polysaccharide vaccine is a common example of polysaccharide vaccines. Then conjugated subunit vaccines, where the polysaccharide chain is actually bound to a carrier protein to boost the immune response. For example, meningococcal ACWY vaccine, which is a conjugate vaccine, which contains polysaccharide from CWY zero groups of this meningococcus organism, and that is coupled to diphtheria or tetanus toxoid and given together basically. Now we are also developing only protein subunit vaccines for COVID-19. It is only protein means where the subunit is only protein. Till now we have not developed that actually. Novavax is basically a company in USA which actually produces nanoparticle coated vaccines basically. So here nanoparticles are actually coated with the different spike proteins of the coronavirus, and when the nanoparticle vaccine is actually injected into the into people, what happens is since the spike proteins are exposed to the immune system, they cause antibody production and the immune response is caused. So this particular vaccine product gives around 96% protection against the original strain, 86% protection against the UK variant, and 55% protection against the South African variant, and it requires two doses of 21 days apart. So, like, then there's something called viral vector vaccine. So viral vector vaccines, they differ from most conventional vaccines that they don't actually introduce the antigen into the body basically. Here, what is the antigen? Antigen is the surface protein or some part of the virus or the pathogen. So these vector virus based vaccines do not directly introduce the antigen into the people's bodies. Instead, they cause the biochemical machinery of the cells of the human body to manufacture these antigens themselves. So here, what these viral vector vaccines do is that through them, you can actually introduce the genetic material of the virus, that is the pathogen, into the human body. And when the genetic material reaches the cells, genetic material uses the machinery of the person, biochemical machinery, to synthesize the antigens themselves. And since the antigens are foreign proteins to the human body, automatically there will be an immune response by the body against these antigens. So the adenovirus-based the viral vector vaccines, actually examples are Johnson & Johnson's vaccine, which is actually, again, a viral vector vaccine. Similarly, Sputnik V is an adenovirus, it's a viral vector vaccine. And also our Covishield or Oxford vaccine. These three are actually viral vector-based vaccines. They don't actually introduce any part of the pathogen into the human body. They just introduce the DNA, the genetic material, which will enter the host cell, means the people's cell, body cells, and then they cause the cells to produce the actual antigen, which is going to actually elicit an immune response. So the immune system detects those the antigen protein manufactured by the human body as foreign proteins, and then they actually mount an immune response against those proteins. So that's how the viral vector vaccines work basically. So by infecting cells and instructing them to make large amounts of antigen, which then trigger an immune response, the vaccine mimics. So what viral vector vaccines, how they work is that they exactly work the scenario is very similar to exactly the same as when an actual pathogen infects the human body. Only thing is that the viral vector here is not a pathogen. It only introduces the genetic material, that is the DNA here. After that, whatever happens is very similar to actual infection, which happens when the organism infects. So by giving the genetic material into the to the human body, the viral vector vaccines will cause the human bodies to actually manufacture the vaccine using their own biochemical machinery to produce the antigen against which the immune response will be mounted. This advantage of triggering a short, strong cellular and immune response by T cells, as well as the production of antibodies by B cells. Example of viral vector vaccine is the RVSV Zebo vaccine against Ebola, which is the old one. Now we can see our own coronavirus vaccines based on this technology. So as you can see, the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine is based upon adenovirus based technology. Here, double-stranded DNA encoding for the spike protein is protected in a safe virus. The infected cell expresses the spike protein, that is human cell, which leads to immune response. So the efficacy of this vaccine is 82% against the original strain, and 10% against South Africa variant, not very much. And two doses are given 12 weeks apart. That is the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine, which is very popular in India. It's also called as AOX1 or AZD1222, that is Covishield, as they call it in India. Then Johnson & Johnson vaccine, which is actually widely used in USA. Again, it's a viral vector vaccine. A double-stranded DNA is encoding the spike proteins, actually enclosed sent into the cell through adenovirus, which actually passes the genetic material into the cells. Cells will express the spike protein, and then immune response is mounted. Efficacy is 72% against original strain, and then moderate to severe cases, 57% against the South Africa variant. Only one dose is sufficient for this. Unlike other vaccines, which require two doses, Johnson & Johnson requires only one dose. Then finally, Sputnik V, which is also being adopted in India, that's Gamaleya Institute by Russia, who developed this vaccine. Again, double-stranded DNA. Actually, if you see here, the Gamaleya vaccines, they actually code for two different proteins. That is, first is AD26 spike protein, second is second dose is AD20, AD5, basically. So there's slight variation here, actually. Whereas in the previous case also, actually, there's only one protein, basically. Whereas in this case, 45, it is two proteins. So first dose is based upon AD20, second is based upon AD5. So double-stranded DNA, again, code encoding for the spike protein is encapsulated in a virus. Infected cell, again, will actually produce the antigen, that is the spike protein, which against which immune response will be given. So efficacy is 91% against the original strain. The efficacy against the other strain variant is not known. Dosing is 0.5 ml dose, two doses, 21 days apart, again, for the Russian Gamaleya vaccine. Now, DNA vaccines. So till now, we have seen inactivated vaccines. Then we saw subunit vaccines. Then we saw adenovirus-based viral vector vaccines. Now we'll see DNA vaccines. Now, DNA vaccines, the name itself implies, they consist of a piece of DNA encoding the antigen. It's first inserted into a bacterial plasmid. So take the gene coding for a particular protein encoding antigen and then insert into a bacterial plasmid. Inject the plasmid into a host as a vaccine. Then the DNA plasmids carrying the antigen are usually injected into the muscle. Now, one of the challenges here is to how to get the DNA fragment into the cell. Because anyway, once you give DNA, the biochemical machinery of the human body has to use the DNA to manufacture the antigen using its own biochemical machinery. So, but since the biochemical machinery is situated inside the cell, the challenge is to get the DNA into the cell, basically. With the case of adenovirus vaccines, the adenovirus is able to directly inject the genetic material into the cells. But in this case, since we are injecting only the DNA, we have to find some means to get the DNA into the cells using. So, because the machinery for producing the translating the DNA into the protein is present in the cells only. So, various technologies have been developed to aid this process. Such as electroporation is basically using small pulses of electric current to create temporary pores in the membrane through which DNA can be injected. Second is a gene gun, which uses helium to propel DNA into cells, into skin cells. Then encapsulating the DNA. And the third is to encapsulate the DNA in nanoparticles so that which can be taken by the cell, which can fuse the cell membrane. So these three technologies are used to send the DNA into the cells. Because unlike in adenovirus vector vaccine, where the virus directly is able to send the DNA into the cells, here, since the vaccine is just pure DNA of the particular antigen protein, there should be a means to send the DNA into the cells. So these are the technologies being explored. So Zykov-D is an example of DNA vaccine. Zykov-D is basically coronavirus vaccine, which contains the instructions for making spike protein against the SARS-CoV-2 spike protein. It is produced by Zydus Cadila, that is Ahmedabad-based company. They have developed this technology basically. This is the only DNA vaccine. Incidentally, it is the only DNA vaccine in the world for COVID-19. Vaccination gives the code to the cells in the recipient's body that begin making the spike protein, the virus. The immune system of the recipient recognizes this and develops antibodies in response. Vaccine is administered intradermally using the spring mechanism that delivers the shot as a narrow stream of fluid penetrating the skin. As you can see the picture here, you got a DNA pathogen here. DNA, the antigen part of the DNA is actually taken and cloned into a plasmid, and that is actually inserted into injected into the human body. And by one of the technologies which you have spoken about, electroporation or a gene gun or encapsulation, the DNA enters the cells, and then the cells will actually manufacture the translate the DNA into the foreign protein, and then they actually express the surface. So cells will express the protein on the surface. And when the cells express the protein on the surface, immune response is generated against the particular foreign protein. So this is a way by which DNA vaccine works. And Zydus Cadila is an example of Indian company which has produced the world's first DNA vaccine against coronavirus, that is SARS-CoV-2 infection. Next is mRNA vaccines. Now, mRNA vaccines encode the antigen of interest. The mRNA vaccines are basically, in fact, it's halfway closer to the target. That is, DNA vaccines, DNA has to be transferred to mRNA, and the mRNA has to be expressed as protein. But here you are supplying the mRNA of the pathogen of the antigen of interest itself to the human body. Because of its transitory nature, there's no zero risk of integrating into our own genetic material. mRNA can be injected by itself, encapsulated by nanoparticles, or driven into the cells using some of the same techniques being developed for DNA. So like gene gun electroporation and encapsulation techniques can be used to send mRNA into the cells. And the mRNA, safe thing is it does not integrate with it does not disturb the human germ in any way. And in fact, once the mRNA enters the cell, after instructions are taken to actually synthesize the protein, the mRNA will be destroyed. It won't be intact in the cell. So Moderna is a company in USA which makes encapsulated mRNA vaccine. So the mRNA encoding for the spike protein is protected in a lipid nanoparticle like a soap bubble. Once absorbed, the cell expresses the spike protein, resulting in immune response. So efficacy is 94% of the original strain. Efficacy is not known against South Africa variant. And the storage is around -20 degrees Celsius for 6 months and 28 degrees Celsius for 30 days. Again, it takes 2 doses for this vaccine, 28 days apart. That is, gap is 28 days. So this is Moderna, a US-based company producing mRNA vaccine against SARS-CoV-2. Again, BioNTech, Pfizer, again, they are producing an mRNA vaccine. Pfizer, again, is again a US-based company. And BioNTech, actually, the company is a German-based company, basically. So they are collaborating to make this BioNTech, Pfizer vaccine. Again, mRNA is actually encapsulated in a suitable nanoparticle. And then the technology is the same. The spike proteins, the mRNA for spike protein is given into the cells. The human cell sector synthesize the spike protein, and then immune system actually recognizes that and develops the antibodies for this. Efficacy is 96%. However, storage temperature is around -70 degrees Celsius. And because since this vaccine is has not been wrapped in India very widely, because India, we don't have stringent storage facilities for large amounts of vaccine, that is around -70 Celsius. So it's better to go for, that's why we have found it better to go for other vaccines where the temperature storage is much higher compared to -70 degrees Celsius. So this is the only problem with the BioNTech Pfizer vaccine, because storage temperature is very low, -70 degrees Celsius. So this is a brief thing how mRNA COVID vaccine and vaccines work. Like the one that Cosco is named after the crown-like spikes on their surface called spike proteins. mRNA basically is, you know, it's a messenger RNA, which is actually copied from the DNA basically. And when it goes into the cell, it does not disturb the genome of the host's genome. It actually only delivers instructions for manufacturing the protein. And once the protein is actually manufactured, the mRNA is destroyed. So that's why mRNA vaccines are quite safe. So that actually completes the presentation on this COVID-19 vaccines, current technologies for that. Thank you.
Dear participants, the chat box has been opened. If you have any queries, you can post your queries in the chat box. I repeat.
It's a whole virus vaccine. It's very simple in the sense that the whole virus is either attenuated or deactivated, and this is actually used as a vaccine because the vaccine is a weakened or deactivated form of the pathogen causes COVID-19 trigger the immunity to it. So you either attenuate the COVID-19 virus or you deactivate the virus and produce a vaccine out of it. That's called whole virus vaccine, and it's a traditional form of a vaccine. In fact, lots of vaccines have been produced using whole viruses, for example, rabies vaccine, hepatitis A vaccine. If you look at any pharmacopoeia, old pharmacopoeia, you will see that most of the vaccines are produced by inactivation of viruses, basically. Inactivation. So, the whole virus vaccines are mostly produced by inactivated or inactivation or attenuation of the virus, basically. So, Chinese vaccines, COVID vaccines like Sinopharm and Sinovac, are based on this technology, that is, whole virus vaccines. Since the pathogen is inactivated, it cannot infect cells and replicate, but can evoke an immune response. So killing of the deactivation of the pathogen does not mean that it cannot evoke immune response, because immune response evoking is dependent on the structural proteins. That is, so as long as the proteins are intact, even though the virus may be inactive, you can still elicit an immune response. That is the scientific principle behind using inactivated viruses as vaccines. So they were one of the earliest to be developed inactivated viruses. Towards the 19th century, the first in vaccines were developed by Salmon in the United States and Smith in the Pasteur Institute group in France. That was towards the 19th century. Now, what discovery led to the adoption of this particular technology? It was found, that if bacteria can be killed, they can still have evoke an immune response. So, since bacteria can evoke an immune response even if they are killed by chemical treatment or heat, the same logic was applied to viruses also. So, viruses also could actually can also evoke an immune response even though they are inactivated. That is the principle behind the whole virus vaccine. However, after successive attempts and strategies, various centers, the 20th century, the first vaccine, that is whole virus vaccine, was the influenza vaccine. Influenza vaccine is the first whole virus vaccine to come out. Second was actually beta propiolactin inactivated viral vaccine, was a rabies vaccine. So first is influenza virus, then rabies virus. Then finally, we have got the polio vaccine, which came out in 1950, which was the third whole virus vaccine to be produced in the world, actually. So we have got influenza, rabies, and polio vaccine in the among the earliest vaccines produced by whole virus vaccine technology. So they are produced by inactivating the, we can't use the term killing for viruses because we don't consider viruses as living organisms. So we can say they are produced by inactivating the organisms that cause disease through physical or chemical processes. This destroys the pathogen's ability to replicate, but keeps it intact so that the immune response can still recognize it and produce an immune response. So immune system can recognize the inactivated viruses and can still produce an immune response, which will be active against live pathogens. Now, till date, several inactivated viral vaccines have been produced. They are namely against hepatitis A, influenza, polio, rabies, and they offer excellent protection. These inactivated vaccines will be administered along with adjuvants. Adjuvants are basically substances which actually increase the immune response. That is, the adjuvant is basically an inert substance which does not interfere with the efficacy of the vaccine, but which actually causes the immune response to be stronger. That's why we call them adjuvant. So adjuvants are to immune response produced. Adjuvant is an ingredient used in some vaccines that helps create a stronger immune response in people receiving the vaccine. So some of the adjuvants commonly used are aluminium salts like aluminium hydroxide, aluminium phosphate, aluminium potassium sulfate. They have been used for vaccines for more than 70 years. In fact, I was associated with the hepatitis B vaccine recombinant, and we used to add this aluminium hydroxide gel, the final stage for formulating. So you generally add the adjuvant when you formulate the vaccine. So until the vaccine is formulated, it remains an antigen protein. So once you mix the adjuvant with the antigen, it becomes a vaccine. So when we add aluminum hydroxide gel to hepatitis B surface antigen protein, what you get is the hepatitis B vaccine. So similar to that, if you add the adjuvant to any preparation which is going to become become the vaccine, then addition of adjuvant to the active ingredient will make it a vaccine. So process in order the development of let us see briefly the process. As you can see here, first you select a bacterial or viral strain against the disease, then inactivated using heating or chemicals. Then the vaccine is produced by actually harvesting the organism cells and then by formulating them properly. Then you inject the inactivated vaccine into the patient into people. Then you get neutralizing antibodies finally and immune responses evoked. This is briefly the process. It's a very simple process. Production of inactivated vaccine is quite well known. It's not a new technology, but still, it is being adopted worldwide because they produce excellent protection. Now, let's look at the steps basically. So, whole viruses or bacteria are extracted and grown in culture. Viruses or bacteria that are inactivated by killing by chemicals such as formalin or formaldehyde or beta propiolactone, which is BPL. Then the inactivated viruses or bacteria are then produced in large quantities, means. So that we'll produce millions of doses of the vaccine so that they can be given to the entire population prepared for use of the vaccine. So what are advantages of polio vaccines? Because they are proven to be extremely safe as don't contain any live components. So since the organisms in the vaccine are completely inactivated, there's no question of any disease spreading from that. The pathogen is completely inactivated. So there's no question of any disease or the disease being caused by the pathogen. It can be given to special populations such as old people, geriatric populations, pregnant women, and also to children, infants, babies basically. So they can be given to that. And they also ensure stability for long-term storage. And technically, you require only few regulatory hurdles. Means because this is a well-known technology, the regulatory authorities are not very strict about production of this inactivated vaccines because the technology has been adopted worldwide and for many vaccines. So people know exactly it's a proven technology. It's a proven technology, and so you don't encounter too many technical regulatory hurdles for getting the license. And they cater to the new requirement of the current healthcare environment, where the focus is on reducing costs while improving overall patient care. So since this is an old technology, the cost of implementing this technology is also less compared to other advanced technologies. So in a scenario where cutting cost is important, this traditional whole virus vaccines technology is very useful. Some examples for this are Bharat Biotech is producing Covaxin. Covaxin is produced exactly by this technology, that is whole virus vaccine technology, where you have the inactivated virus, which itself acts as the vaccine. So inactivated virus is chemically inactivated with a chemical agent called beta propiolactone. That is the coronavirus is inactivated using this chemical, and then it's injected, vaccine is prepared and it's injected into the into people. And since the virus entire is intact, only it's inactive, it's able to elicit immune response. That is so next is Sinopharm. Sinopharm again uses the same technology, which is a Chinese company, and dosing is around two doses 21 days apart, whereas in the case of Bharat Biotech, it's actually two doses 28 days apart, the vaccination, that is the gap between the vaccines. And Sinopharm is actually two doses 21 days apart, storage is at 28 degrees Celsius. Next is subunit vaccine. Now, later on, this technology came into being. That is, people started that, is it necessary to actually inactivate the whole organism and then use it as a vaccine? Can't we take a part of the organism and use it as a vaccine? So that's what we call subunit vaccines came into existence. Subunit means can be a part of the pathogen. It can be a surface protein mostly. So instead of taking the whole organism, you take only a part of the organism, which is exposed to the immune system basically in the world. So if you take a surface protein, we obviously know that the surface of the pathogen is going to be exposed to the immune system. So in that case, if you take the surface protein of an organism, of a virus, and then if you prepare a vaccine using that particular surface protein, then it's possible to get the same immune response using a small part of the surface of the organism basically. So that's why you call them as subunit vaccines. They contain purified pieces of the vaccine, which have been specially selected for the ability to stimulate immune cells. Hepatitis B vaccine recombinant is a very common example of a subunit vaccine. So what people have done is they have taken the gene for the surface protein, a small protein from the surface hepatitis B virus. They cloned the gene into plasmid, and they have actually integrated a plasmid into host cell, suitable host cell, which actually integrates the plasmid into the chromosome. And then when the organism multiplies, the gene also multiplies. You have got this gene of that particular subunit protein in high copy number. So from that, the gene will be expressed actually, and the subunit protein will be expressed by the yeast cell, the recombinant yeast cell, and the yeast will be harvested, the cells will be broken, and vaccine will be prepared. So that's how subunit vaccines are prepared. And I was working for hepatitis B recombinant. I was in the team who were manufacturing hepatitis B recombinant vaccine. So since I was with the team, I know exactly how it is being done. So that's why I gave an example of subunit vaccine recombinant. And this is the fragments are capable of causing a disease. Subunit vaccines are considered very safe because at least in whole virus, people may have some doubt that is the whole virus is there, they can cause. But in this case, there's no question of any disease being caused by the vaccine because you are taking only a small part of the pathogen. That is. Now, types of subunit vaccines. So briefly, there are three different types of subunit vaccines. protein subunit vaccines. They contain specific isolated proteins from viral or bacterial pathogens. Example, hepatitis B vaccine, which I mentioned just now, hepatitis B vaccine. The polysaccharide vaccines are there because contains chains of sugar molecules found in the cell walls of many bacteria. For example, pneumococcal polysaccharide vaccine is a common example of polysaccharide vaccines. Then conjugated subunit vaccines, where the polysaccharide chain is actually bound to a carrier protein to boost the immune response. For example, meningococcal ACWY vaccine, it's a conjugate vaccine which contains polysaccharides from CWY zero groups of this meningococcus organism, and that is coupled to diphtheria or tetanus toxoid and given together basically. Now we are also developing only protein subunit vaccines for COVID-19. It is only protein means where the subunit is only protein. Till now we have not developed that actually. Novavax is basically a company in USA which actually produces nanoparticle coated vaccines basically. So here nanoparticles are actually coated with the different spike proteins of the coronavirus, and when the nanoparticle vaccine is actually injected into the into people, what happens is, since the spike proteins are exposed to the immune system, they cause antibody production and the immune response is caused. So this particular vaccine product gives around 96% protection against the original strain, 86% protection against the UK variant, and 58% protection against the South African variant, and it requires two doses of 21 days apart. So like then there's something called viral vector vaccine. So viral vector vaccines, they differ from most conventional vaccine that they don't actually introduce the antigen into the body basically. Here, what is the antigen? Antigen is the surface protein or some part of the virus or the pathogen. So these vector virus based vaccines do not directly introduce the antigen people's bodies. Instead, they cause the biochemical machinery of the cells of the human body to manufacture these antigens themselves. So here, what these viral vector vaccines do is that through them, you can actually introduce the genetic material of the virus, that is the pathogen, into the human body. And when the genetic material reaches the cells, genetic material uses the machinery of the person, biochemical machinery, to synthesize the antigens themselves. And since the antigens are foreign proteins to the human body, automatically there will be an immune response by the body against these antigens. So the adenovirus based the viral vector vaccines, actually examples are Johnson & Johnson's vaccine, which is actually again a viral vector vaccine. Similarly, Sputnik V is an adenovirus, it's a viral vector vaccine, and also our Covishield or Oxford vaccine. These three are actually viral vector based vaccines. They don't actually introduce any part of the pathogen into the human body. They just introduce the DNA, the genetic material, which will enter the host cell, means the people's cell, the body cells, and then they cause the cells to produce the actual antigen, which is going to actually elicit an immune response. So the immune system detects those the antigen protein manufactured by the human body as foreign proteins, and then they actually develop an immune response against those proteins. So that's how the viral vector vaccines work basically. So by infecting cells and instructing them to make large amounts of antigen, which then trigger an immune response, the vaccine mimics. So what viral vector vaccines, how they work is that they exactly work when the scenario is very similar to exactly the same as when an actual pathogen infects the human body. Only thing is that the viral vector here is not a pathogen. It only introduces the genetic material, that is the DNA here. After that, whatever happens is very similar to actual infection, which happens when the organism infects. So by giving the genetic material into the to the human body, the viral vector vaccines will cause the human bodies to actually manufacture the vaccine using their own biochemical machinery to produce the antigen against which the immune response will be mounted. This advantage of triggering a strong cellular and immune response by T cells, as well as the production of antibodies by B cells. Example of viral vector vaccine is the RVSV Zebo vaccine against Ebola, which is the old one. Now we can see our own coronavirus vaccines based on this technology, that is. So as you can see, the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine is based upon adenovirus based technology. Here, double-stranded DNA encoding the for spike protein is protected in a safe virus. Infected cell expresses the spike protein, that is human cell, which leads to immune response. So efficacy of this vaccine is 82% against the original strain, and 10% against South Africa variant, not very much. And two doses are given 12 weeks apart. That is the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine, which is very popular in India. It's also called as AOX1 or AZD1222, that is Covishield, as they call it in India. Then Johnson & Johnson vaccine, which is actually widely used in USA, again, it's a viral vector vaccine. A double-stranded DNA is encoding the spike proteins actually enclosed sent into a cell through adenovirus, which actually passes the genetic material into the cells. Cells will express the spike protein and then immune response is mounted. Efficacy is 72% against original strain, and then moderate to severe cases, 57% against the South Africa variant. Only one dose is sufficient for this. Unlike other vaccines, which require two doses, Johnson & Johnson requires only one dose. Then finally, Sputnik V, which is also being adopted in India. That's Gamaleya Institute by Russia, who have developed this vaccine. Again, double-stranded DNA. Actually, if you see here, the Gamaleya vaccines, they actually code for two different proteins. That is, first is AD26 spike protein, second dose is AD20-85, basically. So there's slight variation here, actually. Whereas in the previous case also, actually, there's only one protein, basically. Whereas in this case, Sputnik V, it is two proteins. So first dose is based upon AD20, second is based upon AD5. So double-stranded DNA, again, encoding for the spike proteins is encapsulated in a virus. Infected cell, again, will actually produce the antigen, that is the spike protein, against which immune response will be given. So efficacy is 91% against the original strain. The efficacy against the other strain variant is not known. Dosing is 0.5 ml dose, two doses, 21 days apart, again, for the Russian Gamaleya vaccine. Now, DNA vaccines. So till now, we have seen inactivated vaccines. Then we saw subunit vaccines. Then we saw adenovirus-based viral vector vaccines. Now we'll see DNA vaccines. Now, DNA vaccines, the name itself implies, they consist of a piece of DNA encoding the antigen. It's first inserted into a bacterial plasmid. So take the gene coding for a particular protein, encoding antigen, and then insert into a bacterial plasmid. Inject the plasmid into a host as a vaccine. Then the DNA plasmids carrying the antigen are usually injected into the muscle. Now, one of the challenges here is to how to get the DNA fragment into the cell. Because once you give DNA, the biochemical machinery of the human body has to use the DNA to manufacture the antigen using its own biochemical machinery. So, but since the biochemical machinery is situated inside the cell, the challenge is to get the DNA into the cell, basically. With the case of adenovirus vaccines, the adenovirus is able to directly inject the genetic material into the cells. But in this case, since we are injecting only the DNA, we have to find some means to get the DNA into the cells using. So, because the machinery for producing the translating the DNA into the protein is present in the cells only. So, various technologies have been developed to aid this process, such as electroporation is basically using small pulses of electric current to create temporary pores in the membrane through which DNA can be injected. Second is a gene gun, which uses helium to propel DNA into skin cells. Then encapsulating the DNA. And the third is to encapsulate the DNA in nanoparticles which can be taken by the cell, which can fuse the cell membrane. So these three technologies are used to send the DNA into the cells. Because unlike in adenovirus vector vaccine, where the virus directly is able to send the DNA into the cells, here, since the vaccine is just pure DNA of the particular antigen protein, there should be a means to send the DNA into the cells. So these are technologies being explored. So Zykov-D is an example of DNA vaccine. Zykov-D is basically coronavirus vaccine, which contains the instructions for making spike protein against the SARS-CoV-2 spike protein. It is produced by Zydus Cadila, that is Ahmedabad-based company. They have developed this technology basically. This is the only DNA vaccine. Incidentally, it is the only DNA vaccine in the world for COVID-19. Vaccination gives the code to the cells in the recipient's body that begin making the spike protein of the virus. The immune system of the recipient recognizes this and develops antibodies in response. Vaccine is administered intradermally using the spring mechanism that delivers the shot as a narrow stream of fluid penetrating the skin. As you can see the picture here, you got a DNA pathogen here. DNA, the antigen part of the DNA is actually taken and cloned into a plasmid, and that is actually inserted into injected into the human body. And by one of the technologies which you have spoken about, electroporation or a gene gun or encapsulation, the DNA enters the cells, and then the cells will actually manufacture the translate the DNA into the foreign protein, and then they actually express the surface. So the cells will express the protein on the surface, and when the cells express the protein on the surface, immune response is generated against the particular foreign protein. So this is a way by which DNA vaccine works, and Zydus Cadila is an example of Indian company which has produced the first world's first DNA vaccine against coronavirus, that is SARS-CoV-2 infection. Next is mRNA vaccines. Now, mRNA vaccines encode the antigen of interest. The mRNA vaccines are basically, in fact, it's halfway closer to the target. That is, DNA vaccines, DNA has to be transferred to mRNA, and the mRNA has to be expressed as protein. But here you are supplying the mRNA of the pathogen of the antigen of interest itself to the human body. Because of its transitory nature, there's no zero risk of integrating into our own genetic material. mRNA can be injected by itself, encapsulated by nanoparticles, or driven into the cells using some of the same techniques being developed for DNA. So like gene gun, electroporation, and encapsulation techniques can be used to send mRNA into the cells. And mRNA, safe thing is it does not integrate with it does not disturb the human germ in any way. And in fact, once the mRNA enters the cell, after instructions are taken to actually synthesize the protein, the mRNA will be destroyed. It won't be intact in the cell. So Moderna is a company in USA which makes encapsulated mRNA vaccine. So the mRNA encoding for the spike protein is protected in a lipid nanoparticle like a soap bubble. Once absorbed, the cell expresses the spike protein, resulting in immune response. So efficacy is 94% of the original strain. Efficacy is not known against South Africa variant, and the storage is around -20 degrees Celsius for 6 months and 28 degrees Celsius for 30 days. Again, it takes two doses for this vaccine 28 days apart. That is, gap is 28 days. So this is Moderna, a US-based company producing mRNA vaccine against SARS-CoV-2. Again, BioNTech, Pfizer, again, they are producing mRNA vaccine. Pfizer, again, is a US-based company. And BioNTech, actually, the company is a German-based company, basically. So they are collaborating to make this BioNTech, Pfizer vaccine. Again, mRNA is actually encapsulated in a suitable nanoparticle, and then the technology is the same. The spike proteins, the mRNA for spike protein is given into the cells. The human cells synthesize the spike protein, and then immune system actually recognizes that and develops the antibodies for this. Efficacy is 96%. However, storage temperature is around -70 degrees Celsius, and because this vaccine is this vaccine has not been wrapped in India very widely, because India, we don't have stringent storage facilities for large amounts of vaccine, that is around -70 Celsius. So it's better to go for, that's why we have found it better to go for other vaccines where the temperature of storage is much higher compared to -70 degrees Celsius. So this is the only problem with the BioNTech Pfizer vaccine, because storage temperature is very low, -70 degrees Celsius. So this is a brief thing how mRNA COVID vaccine and vaccines work, like the one that caused COVID is named after the crown-like spikes on their surface called spike proteins. mRNA basically is, it's a messenger RNA which is actually copied from the DNA basically, and when it goes into the cell, it does not disturb the genome of the host's genome. It actually only delivers instructions for manufacturing the protein. And once the protein is actually manufactured, the mRNA is destroyed. So that's why mRNA vaccines are quite safe. So that actually completes the presentation on this COVID-19 vaccines, current technologies for that. Thank you.
Dear participants, the chat box has been opened. If you have any queries, you can post your queries in the chat box. I repeat.
Vaccine is a whole virus vaccine. It's very simple in sense that the whole virus is either attenuated or deactivated. And this is actually used as a vaccine because the vaccine is a weakened or deactivated form of the pathogen process of COVID-19 trigger the immunity to it. So you either attenuate the COVID-19 virus or you deactivate the virus and produce a vaccine out of it. That's called whole virus vaccine. And it's a traditional form of a vaccine. In fact, lots of vaccines have been produced using whole viruses. For example, rabies vaccine, hepatitis A vaccine. If you look at any pharmacopoeia, old pharmacopoeia, you will see that most of the vaccines are produced by inactivation of viruses, basically inactivation. So the whole virus vaccines are mostly produced by inactivated or inactivation or attenuation of the virus, basically. So Chinese vaccines, COVID vaccines like Sinopharm and Sinovac are based on this technology, that is whole virus vaccines. Since the pathogen is inactivated, it cannot infect cells and replicate, but can evoke an immune response. So killing of the deactivation of the pathogen does not mean that it cannot evoke immune response, because immune response evoking is dependent on the structural proteins. That is, so as long as the proteins are intact, even though the virus may be inactive, you can still elicit an immune response. That is the scientific principle behind using inactivated viruses as vaccines. So they were one of the earliest to be developed inactivated viruses. Towards the 19th century, the first vaccines were developed by Salmon in the United States and Smith in the Pasteur Institute group in France. That was towards the 19th century. Now, what discovery led to the adoption of this particular technology? It was found that if bacteria can be killed, they can still have evoke an immune response. So, since bacteria can evoke an immune response even if they are killed by chemical treatment or heat, the same logic was applied to viruses also. So viruses also could actually, can also evoke an immune response even though they are inactivated. That is the principle behind the whole virus vaccine. However, after successive attempts and strategies, various centers, the 20th century, the first vaccine, that is whole virus vaccine, was the influenza vaccine. Influenza vaccine is the first whole virus vaccine to come out. Second was actually beta propiolactin inactivated viral vaccine, was a rabies vaccine. So first is influenza virus, then rabies virus. Then finally, we have got the polio vaccine, which came out in 1950, which was the third whole virus vaccine to be produced in the world, actually. So we have got influenza, rabies, and polio vaccine among the earliest vaccines produced by whole virus vaccine technology. So they are produced by inactivating the we can't use the term killing for viruses because we don't consider viruses as living organisms. So we can say they are produced by inactivating the organisms that cause disease through physical or chemical processes. This destroys the pathogen's ability to replicate but keeps it intact so that the immune response can still recognize it and produce an immune response. So immune system can recognize the inactivated viruses and they can still produce an immune response, which will be active against live pathogens. Now, till date, several inactivated viral vaccines have been produced. They are namely against hepatitis A, influenza, polio, rabies, and they offer excellent protection. These inactivated vaccines will be administered along with adjuvants. Adjuvants are basically substances which actually increase the immune response. That is, the adjuvant is basically an inert substance which does not interfere with the efficacy of the vaccine, but which actually causes the immune response to be stronger. That's why we call them adjuvant. So adjuvants are basically immune response produced. Adjuvant is an ingredient used in some vaccines that helps create a stronger immune response in people receiving the vaccine. So some of the adjuvants commonly used are aluminium salts like aluminium hydroxide, aluminium phosphate, aluminium potassium sulfate. They have been used for vaccines for more than 70 years. In fact, I was associated with the hepatitis B vaccine recombinant, and we used to add this aluminium hydroxide gel in the final stage for formulating. So you generally add the adjuvant when you formulate the vaccine. So until the vaccine is formulated, it remains an antigen protein. So once you mix the adjuvant with the antigen, it becomes a vaccine. So when we add aluminium hydroxide gel to hepatitis B surface antigen protein, what you get is the hepatitis B vaccine. So similar to that, if you add this adjuvant to any preparation which is going to become going to act as become the vaccine, then addition of adjuvant to the active ingredient will make it a vaccine. So process involved in the development of let us see briefly the process. As you can see here, we should select a bacterial or viral strain against the disease, then inactivate it using heating or chemicals. Then the vaccine is produced by actually harvesting the organism cells and then by formulating them properly. Then you inject the inactivated vaccine into the patient into people. Then you get neutralizing antibodies finally and immune responses evoked. This is briefly the process. It's a very simple process. Production of inactivated vaccine is quite well known. It's not a new technology, but still it is being adopted worldwide because they produce excellent protection. Now let's look at the steps basically. So whole viruses or bacteria are extracted and grown in culture. Viruses or bacteria that are inactivated by killing or by chemicals such as formalin or formaldehyde or beta propiolactone, which is BPL. Then the inactivated viruses or bacteria are then produced in large quantities, means so that we'll produce millions of doses of the vaccine so that they can be given to the entire population prepared for use of the vaccine. So what are the advantages of polio vaccines? Because they are proven to be extremely safe as don't contain any live components. So since the organisms in the vaccine are completely inactivated, there's no question of any disease spreading from that. The pathogen is completely inactivated. So there's no question of any disease or the disease being caused by the pathogen. It can be given to special populations such as old people, geriatric populations, pregnant women, and also to children, infants, babies basically. So they can be given to that. And they also ensure stability for long-term storage. And technically you require only few regulatory hurdles, means because this is a well-known technology, the regulatory authorities are not very strict about production of this inactivated vaccines because the technology has been adopted worldwide and for many vaccines. So people know exactly it's a proven technology. It's a proven technology. And so you don't encounter too many technical regulatory hurdles for getting the license. And they cater to the new requirement of the current healthcare environment where the focus is on reducing costs while improving overall patient care. So since this is an old technology, the cost of implementing this technology is also less compared to other advanced technologies. So in a scenario where cutting cost is important, this traditional whole virus vaccines technology is very useful. Some examples for this are Bharat Biotech is producing Covaxin. Covaxin is produced exactly by this technology, that is whole virus vaccine technology, where you have the inactivated virus, which itself acts as the vaccine. So inactivated virus is chemically inactivated with a chemical agent called beta propiolactone. That is the coronavirus is inactivated using this chemical. And then it's injected, vaccine is prepared and it's injected into the into people. And since the virus entire virus is intact, only it's inactive, it's able to elicit immune response. That is so next is Sinopharm. Sinopharm again uses the same technology, which is a Chinese company. And dosing is around two doses, 21 days apart. Whereas in the case of Bharat Biotech, it's actually two doses, 28 days apart, the vaccination, that is the gap between the vaccines. And Sinopharm is actually two doses, 21 days apart. Storage is at 28 degrees Celsius. Next is subunit vaccine. Now, later on, this technology came into being. That is, people started that, is it necessary to actually inactivate the whole organism and then use it as a vaccine? Can't we take a part of the organism and use it as a vaccine? So that's what we call subunit vaccines came into existence. Subunit means can be a part of the pathogen. It can be a surface protein mostly. So instead of taking the whole organism, you take only a part of the organism, which is exposed to the immune system basically in the world. So if you take a surface protein, we obviously know that the surface of the pathogen is going to be exposed to the immune system. So in that case, if you take the surface protein of an organism, of a virus, and then if you prepare a vaccine using that particular surface protein, then it's possible to get the same immune response using a smaller part of the surface of the organism, basically. So that's why you call them as subunit vaccines. They contain purified pieces of the vaccine, which have been specially selected for the ability to stimulate immune cells. Hepatitis B vaccine recombinant is a very common example of a subunit vaccine. So what people have done is they have taken the gene for the surface protein, a small protein from the surface hepatitis B virus. They cloned the gene into plasmid, and they have actually integrated a plasmid into a host cell, suitable host cell, which actually integrates the plasmid into the chromosome. And then when the organism multiplies, the gene also multiplies. You have got this gene of that particular subunit protein in high copy number. So from that, the gene will be expressed actually, and the subunit protein will be expressed by the yeast cell, recombinant yeast cell, and the yeast will be harvested, the cells will be broken, and vaccine will be prepared. So that's how subunit vaccines are prepared. And I was actually working for hepatitis B recombinant, I was in the team who were manufacturing hepatitis B recombinant vaccine. So since I was with the team, I know exactly how it is being done. So that's why I gave an example of subunit vaccine recombinant. And this is the fragments are capable of causing a disease. Subunit vaccines are considered very safe because at least in whole virus, people may have some doubt that is the whole virus is there, they can cause. But in this case, there's no question of any disease being caused by the vaccine because you are taking only a small part of the pathogen. That is. Now, types of subunit vaccines. So briefly, there are three different types of subunit vaccines. Protein subunit vaccines, they contain specific isolated proteins from viral or bacterial pathogens. Example, hepatitis B vaccine, which I mentioned just now, hepatitis B vaccine. The polysaccharide vaccines are there because contains chains of sugar molecules found in the cell walls of many bacteria. For example, pneumococcal polysaccharide vaccine is a common example of polysaccharide vaccines. Then conjugated subunit vaccines, where the polysaccharide chain is actually bound to a carrier protein to boost the immune response. Example, meningococcal ACWY vaccine. It's a conjugate vaccine which contains polysaccharides from CWY zero groups of this meningococcus organism, and that is coupled to diphtheria or tetanus toxoid and given together basically. Now we are also developing only protein subunit vaccines for COVID-19. It is only protein means where the subunit is only protein. Till now we have not developed that actually. Novavax is basically a company in USA which actually produces nanoparticle coated vaccines basically. So here nanoparticles are actually coated with the different spike proteins of the coronavirus, and when the nanoparticle vaccine is actually injected into people, what happens is since the spike proteins are exposed to the immune system, they cause antibody production and the immune response is caused. So this particular vaccine product gives around 96% protection against the original strain, 86% protection against the UK variant, and 58% protection against the South African variant, and it requires two doses of 21 days apart. So like then there's something called viral vector vaccine. So viral vector vaccines, they differ from most conventional vaccines that they don't actually introduce the antigen into the body basically. Here, what is the antigen? Antigen is the surface protein or some part of the virus or the pathogen. So these vector virus based vaccines do not directly introduce the antigen into the people's bodies. Instead, they cause the biochemical